Welcome everyone to this PowerPoint video presentation called The Scattering and Gathering Message, Part 1, a prophecy all of God's people are to know. And this is truly a message you do not want to miss. The third angel's message, embracing the messages of the first and second angels, is the message for this time. We are to raise aloft the banner on which is inscribed the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Counsels on Health, page 357, paragraph 2. The theme of greatest importance is the third angel's message, embracing the messages of the first and second angels. All should understand the truths contained in these messages. Counsels to Writers and Editors, 29, paragraph 3. There are but few, even of those who claim to believe it, that comprehend the third angel's message. And yet this is the message for this time. It is present truth, but how few take up this message in its true bearing and present it to the people in its power. With many, it has but little force. First Manuscript Release, page 56, paragraph 4. According to this quote, brothers and sisters, very few of our people truly comprehend the third angel's message. And few take up this message in its true bearing. My goal is, as these presentations are being presented to you, that is exactly what we'll be doing. And it is to be presented in its power with force. The only way we can present this in its true bearing that is going to give power to this message is if we have the understanding of the scattering and gathering. I saw that it was wrong for any to refer to the scattering for examples to govern us now in the gathering. For if God should do no more for us now than he did then, Israel would never be gathered. According to this quote, it is wrong for God's people to call the gathering time the scattering time. But how do you know what to call what when if you don't know the scattering and gathering message? And that is a subject we will be covering specifically in parts 2 and 3. Matthew 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Luke 24:27, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So the writings of Moses point to none other than Jesus Christ. And when we get into the subject of the scattering and gathering, it's all about giving us understanding of Christ and that he is exactly who he says he is, and that the prophecies of the Bible are fulfilled exactly as he said they would be. Now we'll be going into the history of the children of Israel and Moses. In Genesis chapter 12, God called a man named Abram. Now, how do we get to Abram? In Genesis 1, we know that God created a man named Adam. Adam had his sons Cain and Abel. You can read that in Genesis 4. We know that Cain killed Abel, and as a result, Seth was the replacement. Adam's generations are listed in Genesis chapter 5. The seventh person from Adam was known as Enoch. So Adam was the first, and the seventh one was Enoch. Enoch had a son named Methuselah. Methuselah had a son named Lamech. And Lamech had a son named Noah. Enoch was the great-grandfather of Noah. We know the story of the flood in Noah's day in Genesis chapter 6 through 9. And then in Genesis chapter 10, it gives us the generations of Noah. In chapter 11, it gives us the generations of his son Shem. Noah had three sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. Now the lineage continues through Shem. Now if you read chapter 11, it takes us all the way from Shem to Terah, who was the father of Abram. Now, as was shared before, God called Abram, whose name later became Abraham. Abraham had a son named Isaac. Isaac had Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, including a daughter. These 12 sons are who the 12 tribes of Israel were named after. One of these 12 sons' name was Joseph. He was the second youngest. Jacob loved Joseph more than all his brothers. He made Joseph a coat of many colors and did make his older sons one. This caused jealousy among the brothers, causing them not to like Joseph. One day they sold him as a slave to the Ishmaelites and told their dad a wild animal had killed him, showing the blood on his coat. The Ishmaelites sold Joseph into Egypt. The Lord had his hand upon Joseph and blessed him in a mighty way, even though he was a slave. Genesis 50:20 tells us that God can take the evil and turn it into good. One day, the Pharaoh later had a dream of the 7 fat cows and the 7 lean cows. This dream represented the 7 years of plenty and the 7 years of famine in the land. It was Joseph who interpreted the dream because the Lord revealed it to him. Joseph told Pharaoh to gather grain during the plenty so they would have enough during the time of famine. That famine was going to be worse, so bad that they wouldn't even remember they had a time of plenty. In the second year of the famine, Joseph's family was hungry, and his brothers went to Egypt to buy grain. When his brothers arrived, Joseph recognized them, but they didn't know who he was. But later, they had a reunion. To learn more about this story, read Genesis chapters 37 through 50. Anyways, Joseph's father Jacob learned that Joseph was still alive, and Joseph found out that his father Jacob was still alive. So he, with the blessing of Pharaoh, had his entire family all move into Egypt, into a land called Goshen. It was a total of 70 of Jacob's family that had moved into Goshen. When Pharaoh died, and Joseph and his brothers died, a new Pharaoh that knew not Joseph nor his brethren became ruler and caused the Hebrews, Israelites, to become slaves. You could read about this in the first couple of verses in Exodus chapter 1. God had told Abraham years before that this was going to happen to his people, that they would become slaves. You could read that in Genesis 15:13. One of the sons of Jacob was Levi. Out of the tribe of Levi came the parents of Moses, who lived in Goshen. Who was Moses? During the time their son Moses was a baby, there was a decree to kill all baby boys because there was a prophecy of a deliverer to come and rescue God's people out of the hands of the Egyptians. As a result, Moses' mom put him in a basket that she had made and put him down the Nile River. And Pharaoh's daughter is the one who found that basket of Moses. Therefore, he was protected. That deliverer was Moses. And you can read about this in Acts chapter 7, verse 35, and Exodus chapters 3 to chapter 15, verse 22. It was Moses, along with his other brother Aaron, that God sent to Pharaoh to tell him to let God's people go. Pharaoh refused to listen, so the Lord sent 10 plagues to Egypt, one by one. The last plague was the death plague on all the firstborn of Egypt. Pharaoh's son died as a result, which caused him to send the children of Israel away, as God said would be done. And he actually thrust them away. He made them move fast. When the children of Israel did their exodus from Egypt, God had them walk through the Red Sea after parting it for them. But then Pharaoh rethought about what he had done, and now he and his men were chasing after the children of Israel. When Pharaoh and his men decided to chase after them, the Lord put a cloud of darkness on one side so the soldiers couldn't see, and a pillar of fire on the other side so the children of Israel could see. After the children of Israel finished crossing, and the Pharaoh and his soldiers were in the midst of the sea, God caused the waters to overflow them. After this, the Lord gushed water for them out of a rock when they were in the wilderness. He rained manna, angel's food, from heaven for 40 years. Their shoes did not wax old, and neither did their clothes. The Lord did all these miracles, as well as many other miracles, before his people at the hand of Moses. The end. Any questions? If so, please post them in the comment section below this video. And please, do not miss out on part 2. We will then be going into the message of the scattering and gathering. Thank you for joining us, friends. Until we meet again, may the good Lord bless and keep each and every one of you. Bye-bye.